Jeff Davidson is a widely acclaimed professional speaker, mega author of 56 books, creator of 24 iPhone apps, and author of 230 ebooks for mobile readers. He holds the registered trademark as the work-life balance expert. Jeff has spoken to audiences across the US and around the world on the topic of having more breathing space, being more productive, and achieving work-life balance.
What's keeping you awake at night? This is Jeff Davidson, and in this recording, we're going to explore how to keep your career in perspective and how to keep it on an upward trajectory. Today, what career professional do you know who doesn't face a boatload of challenges coming in from every direction? Seems like anytime we raise our heads, somebody else has something competing for our time and attention. More tasks, more communication, more information, more competing for our inner being, our essence, our brain power. In a rocky economy, including intense global competition, plus quality issues, plus the need to stay lean and mean within companies, today's career professional is getting hit on all sides. If you're losing sleep over the way your career is progressing or the way your company is progressing, then this session is for you. It's time to take a pulse check and to reassess the big picture of your life, your career, and your business. Now, balancing short and long-term needs has always been a concern for career professionals that aim to succeed. We need to take care of short-term tasks on our way to accomplishing some great long-term achievements. One overriding concern that most career professionals have is that they'll fail to keep pace with change because indeed so much competes for their attention today. In this fast-paced society, you're not alone. Lots of career professionals wake up every morning with the concern, I'm already behind. I'm already behind for the day. I'm already behind for the week. I want you to rest assured right now that you do have the capabilities to keep up with all of the major developments in your industry. Not every little thing, but all of the major developments, and that you indeed can succeed and thrive in this ever-changing world. Let's tackle first the notion of developing the big picture perspective of your pressing problems. If you got out of college at age 22 and you're going to work to age 70, you'll be in your career for 48 years, give or take. Lots of people don't approach their careers with that perspective, that they're going to be working for decades. So one of the first realizations right off the bat is that a successful career is more of a marathon than a sprint. We've all seen people who burn out after just a couple years and end up leaving one industry for another because they don't understand the important notion of pacing themselves. You need proper sleep. You need proper nutrition. You need to take water periodically throughout the day. We all need to be hydrated. We all need these fundamentals. Somehow, some way, people get the notion that they need to be on 24/7, that jipping sleep is okay, that gulping down whatever food they happen to encounter, well, that's fine, it keeps me going. We have to understand right now that if our careers are to last for decades, we need to take care of our bodies, the machine that will carry us through all that time. So maintain the big picture perspective, which essentially says this: I'm in this for the long haul. I've got lots of years to go. I've got people who may be counting on me at work, at home, and I need to be at my best. To be at my best, I need to maintain the big picture perspective. Now, another notion, very important to the career professional who wants to succeed for the long haul, is to anticipate challenges down the road and take early action before things snowball. So this ties into maintaining the big picture perspective of your career. For example, if you can see that technical skills are becoming more and more necessary within your office, within your company, within your career, and maybe the younger people who are being hired, coming into the company or organization, are already armed with a lot of technical skills that, let's face it, you never learned because at the time you were their age, these just weren't applicable. They didn't even exist. Then that probably is a good indication that you want to enroll in some courses. You might want to get better at some of the things that you're asked to do on a regular basis. Particular types of software, particular types of maneuvers on the web, things you can do in terms of graphics, depending on what your job calls for. At every community college, in every major metro area, certainly throughout the U.S., there are all kinds of opportunities to take courses. They can be weekend classes, they can be semester-long classes, they can be specialized seminars. Hereafter, you want to be in a mode of constant learning. You want to be able to say, I can handle this task and I'm willing to plunk down the dollars if my company is not, to maintain the skills that I need to stay vibrant, productive, competitive in my position. Too many people think, well, if the company won't pay for it, then, you know, I'm not going to do it. The company should pay for this. Well, you've got to let go of that mindset. We're in an era today where your skills, your talent, your experience, what you bring to the job, how you can take your unique contribution, your genius, if you will, and expand upon that is the make or break factor in whether or not you proceed in your career on an upward trajectory. So, item number two, if you will, anticipate challenges, take the courses, get the training, get the experience you need so that you can, in fact, last all those decades that your career is likely to last. Now, another notion in terms of keeping your career in perspective, making sure you're on that upward trajectory, is to adopt methods for constantly identifying the vital career resources that will help to propel you. Now, in terms of resources, we could be talking about people, we could be talking about software, equipment, tools, what have you. Resources, in general, assist you in performing better. In the area of people, for example, a resource could be a mentor, could be people who you interact with on a regular basis via email or via social media, could be people you instant message or simply call on the phone, could be a peer network. When you have a question, you can bounce your query off of others. I often do this myself. I'll send out the same question to 8 or 10 people, and invariably within an hour or two, somebody will give me a pretty good answer. And another hour or two, I'll get other good answers. So resources are all around us in terms of equipment, not just software, but if there is some particular item that will help you to be more productive at your desk, whatever it happens to be, once again, whether or not your company or organization will pay for it, if you know that this is vital to your productivity, to your happiness, to your energy level, then go ahead and get it. Because 9 times out of 10, you won't miss the money as time passes, but you will be so, so glad that you went ahead and acquired that item that makes you more productive. Now, what items might that be? I knew somebody years back who, before computers, felt he could be much more effective at a desk if he had his own typewriter, but would not plunk down the $80 it took back then to just get a nice used model. Today, we might be talking about a pocket dictator. We might be talking about an enhanced version of one of your smartphones. We might be talking about actual graphics equipment, drawing equipment, what have you. Go ahead and acquire those tools that will make you be at your best. If the company or organization won't acquire them, go ahead, plunk down the dollars yourself. All right, moving on. We've looked at a big picture perspective of your career, anticipating challenges down the road, acquiring those resources that will help you be at your best. Now, I'm going to talk about striking the dynamic bargain with yourself. And what I mean by this is that invariably, throughout the course of the day, we are hit with a variety of assignments. Some we had from yesterday or weeks ago. Some are long-term projects we're chipping away at. Sometimes 2-3 in the afternoon, you're humming along, you may have three things on your plate, and you think to yourself, okay, if I can just get out the door by 5 o'clock or whatever closing time happens to be, that will be fine. I'll feel satisfied for the day. Lo and behold, as you're working on one of the three items, somebody plunks down on your desk another assignment. Your boss, a coworker, what happens? Whatever. And what happens is all of a sudden your apple cart is upset. You had these three items that you wanted to tackle. You felt you had enough time. You felt you could get out the door in a reasonable manner this evening. And now something else has been added to your plate. So how do you proceed and still feel good about your accomplishments that day? You strike the dynamic bargain with yourself. And what I mean by that is, in this situation where you had three items to compete and say 3 hours to go, you had already crafted a bargain with yourself. Without articulating it, you had essentially concluded that if I finish these three items and I leave, I'm going to feel good about my accomplishments for this afternoon, today, whatever. Now that something's been added, all of a sudden it upsets the apple cart. I might have to handle this one assignment that's been thrown at me, and I might be able to get one of the other three assignments I had on my plate done. So I'm going to recraft my dynamic bargain, which now says this: if I get this new assignment that's been foisted upon me done, and one of the other three items that was on my agenda, I'm going to leave on time and I'm going to feel good about my accomplishments. So by recrafting the dynamic bargain with yourself based on the workflow that you face and based on what assignments that might come out of the blue and be handed to you, you continually get to feel good about your accomplishments for that day and you get to leave on time. Now, what happens when you don't craft the dynamic bargain with yourself? Then anything that you do will never be enough. You leave day after day feeling incomplete. You feel as if you didn't get enough done. You come back the next day feeling behind. Other things are handed to you that upset your apple cart. This is the nature of business. And so you're always in this constant state of flux. You're always in this constant state of feeling as if there's never enough time. You're not proceeding fast enough. The company doesn't appreciate me. Don't they already know what my schedule is? Well, crafting the dynamic bargain takes care of a lot of that internal chatter. So begin using it now. Feel its power. Experience what it's like to leave relatively on time and have a feeling of satisfaction for what you accomplished that day. It works for so many people. It can work for you. Let's move on to the notion of leaving work feeling good about your accomplishments, which ties in directly to crafting the dynamic bargain with yourself. So many people, and you may be among them, even if they put in a good productive day, even if they've crafted the dynamic bargain with themselves, just to make sure they can kind of stay ahead in the career game, stuff a few projects into their briefcase and bring it home with them. Well, what happens when you bring work home is that you feel a little guilty about bringing it home because maybe you're supposed to be spending time now with your spouse or significant other, your kids, what have you, and you don't quite get to what you brought in your briefcase, so you feel guilty that it's just sitting there. You feel guilty for having brought it home. You come back to work the next day. You don't feel good about the fact that you weren't completely with the people in your household. And this chain effect takes place. You're not completely comfortable at work. You're not completely comfortable at home because you're always shuffling work and projects back and forth, not necessarily getting to them or getting to them and making any real accomplishment. I want you to break this pattern by leaving several days a week after striking the dynamic bargain with yourself and bringing no work home with you. No work home. Now these days, we all know that you don't even have to bring a briefcase, you don't have to bring file folders. Merely bringing a smartphone with you, which you carry all the time anyways, represents the potential to bring work home with you, because there's so much you can store and so much you can do in terms of communicating with others. So I want you to follow the same notion, and that is park that baby someplace. Turn the ringer, turn the buzzer, turn the chimes, turn the ringtone off, whatever you happen to have, and actually have a life for the rest of the day. Actually go about your time after work as an ordinary civilian, an ordinary person enjoying his life, her life, at home, at leisure, with friends, whatever you happen to be doing. Having a life for the rest of the day at least a couple times a week is very crucial to your long-term feeling of success and accomplishment in your career. Because indeed, if you go day after day bringing work home, never feeling as if you have a life after the workday, then your workday, your work week, your work year becomes one long sentence. Almost like a prison sentence. You wake up in your 30, you don't know where your 20s went. You wake up in your 40, you don't know where your 30s went. You wake up in your 50, and you don't know where your 40s went, and so on. Having a life for the rest of the day several times a week helps you to break that chain. So it's very, very critical. Okay, so let's briefly recap what we've covered this far. You want to develop a big picture perspective of your career. You want to anticipate challenges and take action early before the challenges begin to overwhelm you. You want to adopt methods for constantly identifying the vital career resources that will help to propel you along. And this can include people, can include software, systems, tools, you name it. You want to constantly strike the dynamic bargain with yourself so that you feel good about your accomplishments and you leave work with a sense of completion. You want to get home feeling good about your accomplishments and have a life for the rest of the day. Now we're going to turn to new approaches to handling your work day in and day out. And the first is what I call forsaking the electronic leash. What do I mean by that? At least for a half hour, an hour, 2 hours, whatever time you can carve out during the day, keep yourself away from the phone, away from email, away from anything that can disturb your concentration. Look, email, smartphones, all the ways in which we can communicate with one another these days, it's just marvelous. It's unbelievable. It's unprecedented. Previous work generations could hardly believe the capabilities we have today. But now and then, you're going to be on tasks that call for your constant attention, your deep concentration, and you don't need to be in contact with anyone for some of these tasks. Indeed, if anyone else has the ability to get in contact with you, it will break your concentration. It will diminish your productivity. Especially when you're working on first-time kinds of tasks, especially when you're doing work that involves conceptual thinking, that requires, let's say, designing a new product or service for your company. Then, in particular, you want to make sure you have some long, uninterrupted schemes so that you can do your very best work. When you have 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 90, 120 minutes, and you know that you're not going to be interrupted because you've barricaded yourself, you've hidden someplace, you've made sure that no one can get in touch with you, you can't be disturbed, you'll be amazed at how your productivity soars. Freed from all the potential disturbances and interruptions and so forth, each of us gets to be at our best in ways that you just can't achieve otherwise. And what often happens is we go into a personal zone of productivity and sometimes end up finishing tasks far more quickly than we might have imagined. So as often as possible, I want you to forsake the electronic leash and give yourself the opportunity to be at your very best for tasks that call for your concerted effort and concentration. Another approach to high productivity is leapfrogging, what I call leapfrogging and picking your spots. And let me explain what I mean by that. It's not always possible to keep pace with every single thing that goes on within your company and your organization. In your particular profession, it's not always possible to keep pace with every development that comes down the pike. Indeed, you could spend every waking hour just reading about the developments in your industry or profession and never have time to actually do your job, never have time to serve a client or customer, because today developments in all lines of work come so quickly. But one way that you can succeed is to engage in leapfrogging, which means you pick a spot in the future, let's say a week from now, a month from now, possibly even a year from now, and say, okay, by this time, I will have achieved X, Y, and Z. By this time, I will have become knowledgeable about this new software, this new project, this new way of proceeding, whatever the issue happens to be. And so by leapfrogging and picking your spots, periodically you get all caught up and in fact may even lead the pack. Then time passes, other developments come down the pike for which you cannot constantly keep pace. We understand that. It's going to continue to happen. But once again, you choose a point in time, be it a day, a week, a month, a year. You pick your spots. You decide the capability or accomplishment in advance, and you leapfrog. You do everything you need to do to get to that point in time and have that capability so that once again you'll be at the front of the pack. And then the cycle repeats itself. All right, so let's do a quick review now of our new approaches to work. So far we've covered two: forsaking the electronic leash and leapfrogging and picking your spots. Now let's move on to another notion, a third notion, if you will, which is building red tape into the equation. Now what the heck does building red tape into an equation mean? In every industry today, government regulation, industry regulation, the paperwork, the forms, the bureaucracy that seems to follow us all cannot be denied, especially if you're running your own department or division, or you're running your own business for that matter. As much as we'd like to forget about red tape, as much as we'd like to forget about the forms and the things we need to fill out, very often they are part of the equation on the path to completing or accomplishing what it is we wish to accomplish. So hereafter, let's start building the red tape into the equation. If we know that a job is going to take us 2 hours and then we know there's going to be another half hour of paperwork, let's consider the job to be 2.5 hours. If we know that we need so many people on a particular project and then we're going to need another person for documentation, reporting, what have you, let's add that other person at the outset. In other words, let's take a realistic notion of what we're up against on tasks and projects, either as solo workers or in a group, you know, with a team. And in having the red tape be built into the equation, we now have a more realistic notion of how long it's going to take, how much it's going to cost, what kinds of difficulties we're going to encounter, and by and large, succeed over and over again over the career competitor who then tacks on the red tape notion of the task or project afterwards and is always in a catch-up mode and always feeling as if there's just more to do, more to do, more to do. We're going to build it in at the outset. All right, let's move on. We also want to streamline our operation. Personally, in a team, in a department or division, and again throughout an entire company. What do I mean by streamlining? If we can handle a project and the reporting only requires one form instead of two, let's do it. If we have feedback forms for our staff, and instead of 8 questions, we can get by with 6 questions. Let's knock it down to 6 questions. In other words, every place we can streamline operations, especially the overhead aspect of operations, the feedback, the reporting, and I mean here the reporting that's up to us, not that's regulated by the government or industry or outside party. Every time we can streamline a form, every time we can reduce bureaucracy within, every time we have the opportunity to make a list, a chart, more streamlined, easier to deal with, easier to understand, then it behooves us to do so, because the long-term benefit of streamlining operations gives us a payoff that occurs over and over and over again. So look at what you do on a regular basis. Look at the ways in which you can make your own operation smoother. Can you make a set of instructions that takes up a half a page instead of flipping through a book of 28 pages to find the handful of key instructions that you use on a regular basis, and so on? Look through everything that you do over and over again that could be streamlined, and have your staff or have your coworkers do the same, and the benefits will just start to pile up. Okay, now let's review some of the new approaches to work that we've discussed that will help to keep your career on an upward trajectory. We're going to continue to forsake the electronic leash when we need that hour or 2 hours to be at our best, to concentrate. We're going to leapfrog and pick our spots, recognizing we can't always keep pace with every single thing that comes down the pike in our industry or profession as it comes down the pike, but we certainly can get to some hallowed vantage point that we choose and then get there again weeks or months later and get there again. We want to build red tape into the equation of the work that we face on a continual basis so that we have a more realistic notion of exactly what it takes to accomplish what we need to accomplish. And we want to streamline operations as often as possible so that we have a faster, easier, more succinct way of proceeding day in and day out. If we do these things in combination, by and by we find that we become one of the more productive people within our offices. More of our teammates and coworkers want to work with us. We get selected for the better projects. We begin to be noticed by the bosses and the higher-ups within the organization. One fine day we find we get called in and are given a new task or a new position or a promotion or a raise when we hadn't even anticipated it was coming, because we have taken the time and effort to do the little things that collectively add up to making one's career trajectory get into high gear, to do the little things that add up to making one's career really blossom. Combined with the notion of maintaining a big picture perspective, anticipating challenges down the road, constantly looking for the vital resources that will help to propel us, striking dynamic bargains with ourselves, leaving on time and feeling good about our accomplishments, and having a life for the rest of the day, we'll find that we can rise faster and further than we might have presumed. That we don't have to work endless hours, that we don't have to throw ourselves at our jobs, that indeed the most successful people in every industry, in every profession, if you ever stopped and looked at them and studied them, don't necessarily walk faster, talk faster, eat faster, sleep less. They're not flustered. They don't seem to be doing tons and tons of extra work. What they have done is identify those key areas in their career and their work on a daily basis and on a long-term basis that help to keep them at their best, that help to keep them vibrant, alert, awake, focused, energized, and directed.
You've been listening to Jeff Davidson, mega author and professional speaker. For more information on Jeff's presentations, his books, and his other products, visit www.breathingspace.com. That's www.breathingspace.com.